Hey guys, welcome back to yourstory.com. I'm Vishal Krishna, your business editor. I've got some real great people coming on the show, but today it's a really special guest, and that too is from academia. It's Mr. Suresh Bhagwatulla, professor at IIMB. We're waiting for him. Hi, Namita, Rajpreet. How's everybody today? Shreyans, good to see you. Master of None, Arjun, nice handle. I'll call you Master of None if you can ping me back at 10 o'clock. Definitely, I'll call you live, man. Nice handle you've got. Hi, Vyom. Good to see you. Okay, so today my guest is Mr. Suresh Bhagwatulla, who's from IIMB. Suresh Bhagwatulla. You have to check out his work. You know what? He has done research on entrepreneurial networks and how they impact you. 1 second. I want to type his name out. Okay, guys, thanks for joining in. And yeah, my guest is Suresh Bhagwatulla, the professor at IIMB, and he studied networks and the impact of networks on entrepreneurship. He's here. I'm going to call him live. 1 second. Go live with Suresh.
Hi, Vishal. Good to see you, man. Navneet. Suresh, I've sent you an invite. You can accept it and we can go live. A lot of people waiting.
You.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Professor.
Good to see you. I'm onto this millennial thing. I've never done Instagram live. So there's always time to learn new things.
You know, the funny thing is, just a couple of months ago, I hadn't done this either. So, yeah, it is a millennial thing too. So, good to see you. And thanks for accepting to come on the show, because we have so many entrepreneurs that keep asking me questions on surviving the pandemic and, you know, working with a network to survive and obviously connect with people with information. And that's the core of your work too. So, while I've informed the audience about what you do, you could give us a quick introduction as to what turned you into a professor. And you could tell us about your work a little bit. And for those of them who are interested, can check out his YouTube videos, right? And then we can take it from there with the questions. Go on, Professor.
Hi, everyone. And thanks a lot, Vishal, for inviting me. I think we need to collectively put our minds together to see how to come out of all this pandemic and lockdown scene. And I joined academics after my PhD. I started my PhD a little late in life. and this is my first academic job.
Okay, where were you working?
I did a whole bunch of things. I was a gig person, so I never worked in the area that I studied in.
Okay.
So I studied chemical engineering and then did mineral processing. Perhaps that was the closest.
Uh-huh.
And many years ago, that was quite some time ago, so more than half of you all may not have been born then. That was like 92, 95, first job, unlikely. And around 95, I was like quite keen on doing a PhD. And the problem was that I didn't want to do it anymore in technology. The thing with it started very early in India that you do engineering and they decide what to do with life.
Absolutely.
And and most of us, that was a bad choice. We didn't want to do that. There's so many other things that one could have done.
Hmm.
So I was also getting excited by this thing called appropriate rural technology. Because what happened was, I was into this really high-end chemical mineral research, and we listened to some star researcher from Colombia. And he was talking about how negatively charged bacteria plaque can stick to negatively charged teeth.
Okay.
And how can the bond be so strong? Right. So that was his quest at that point of time. So I was around 23, 24, and I certainly didn't want to see myself late 40s, early 50s to look at how does plaque stick to your teeth? So all my fascination for science research went down. And then I was talking to people. So I said, to work on oxide ores, when do you think what I'm doing is going to be of value to the industry? Looks at me and says, let me be honest, never. Because we have lots and lots of sulfide ores. We will never use oxide ores. So what you're doing is good for your research, good for publications, but we will not be interested. So that is a huge reality strike to me that if one could be in science, do very relevant stuff, especially in engineering. So I thought, move away and look at more real. So I was looking at appropriate technology, which was into renewable energies and how do you mobility. And that time I realized that a lot of these things are failure in 70s, 80s and 90s when it was very popular because they were not set up into they ended up being projects. Because they were projects,
so that's how you became these a gig guy. So you became a gig guy at that point of time.
No, in the sense that then I studied. I haven't even started. So I studied for about 2 years and realized that you know what, I don't like any of these because these guys are all going to be dependent on somebody else's generosity. And wealth creation is something which is very interesting. So I was doing my practicum training in Kenya. So the nice thing about this university I went to was they sent me to wherever you wanted to do. I was looking for a project in Fiji. I couldn't get any. So I went to then Kenya, not a bad place. So, and there I was exposed to some women working on ventures and what is known as business development services for rural enterprises. Okay. And I was very impressed with small women doing interesting businesses. So I thought I'll come back to India and do something similar.
Okay.
Was
M-Paisa there then? Did you get exposed to that kind of a thing?
Oh, no. This was very early days of internet.
Okay.
Well, M-Paisa was much, much later.
Okay.
I was there exactly 20 years ago. M-Paisa was certainly not around.
Okay.
And I couldn't afford any safaris because I was a student fellowship.
So you can go to
but it kind of exposed me. No, not at all. I still haven't. But I was interested in this wealth creation and the need to create jobs for people in rural areas. So I went and tried setting up 10 ventures in rural areas in Andhra.
Nice.
And except one, everything failed. Right? So I thought I had the right pedigree to do a PhD to understand why ventures fail. And interested in this entire process of starting and running a venture. It's not very easy. It's very tough, right? So I did a PhD in entrepreneurship. So the first job that I did, which is related to my work, is a PhD. So I was happy that I got a job here in IIM. And I was at NSR Cell meeting a lot of interesting entrepreneurs. So I joined in 2007, July, so early days of entrepreneurship in Bangalore. Those days, we couldn't spell entrepreneurship here in Bangalore. So the wonderful thing that people don't realize, especially abroad, is how quickly Bangalore developed to where we are right now, right? How quickly India developed to where we are right now. So that is a real heartening story in terms of the ecosystem that we built extremely rapidly to where we are right now. And my PhD work was looking at networks and how entrepreneurs use their networks to survive and grow. What kind of network structures? Because face-to-face interactions are very important. And networks is like exercising and being healthy. We do that only before we go for a health checkup. So you see me walking around trying to reduce my cholesterol just before March because I know I need to go for a health checkup, right? So that's not how you need to look at networking because that's not how you need to look at health. And
absolutely.
So networks are very, very influential.
So you can't be put in a go into a network just to raise seed capital. It is much more beyond that, right?
Yeah, so the best time to have started networks was 10 years ago.
Yes.
And the next best time is now.
Why would you say, please?
Because if you don't have a network that helps you right away, mm-hmm. you are losing to people who have networks that are conditioned to help them. So it's a competition between you and your network contacts mm-hmm. versus another venture with their network contacts.
Absolutely.
So if their network contacts get them information or get their name dropped at multiple places, then you start to, it's like butterfly effect, right? So your name gets dropped at three different places. Somebody gives you, becomes your beta customer, says nice things, and somebody else comes in. So it kind of slowly builds one on another.
Okay. For for the benefit of our audience, let's talk about the history of networks itself quickly. And maybe you could tell them how it's changed from a generation where we had those dial phones, no phones. And, you know, when cell phones came, how did networks change? Then how did the events business or people like Your Story, obviously we are a niche network player in a way, we create networks. The role of Facebook and all that to create a network for entrepreneurs. You know, then we can tie in why is this the right time to be part of a network and how you can actually build your business using this network.
Yeah, so man by nature is a social animal. And there are instances that a lot of stories that we get to hear are outcomes of networks that people are embedded in. There's a story that people relate to that the Freedom Run that Paul Rivery or whoever that person was, he ran, I think, about 80 to 100 kilometers to tell the Americans in just before the 1776 war that British are going to attack. And British were planning to surprise the Americans. And Paul and a bunch of people came to know of it. But apparently two people were sent in two different directions. No. But one is been relegated to only historians mm-hmm. and the other became a hero to the population at large to the extent that we still talk of him so many hundred years later. And they look and they feel that it was his network that made him so effective that Britain and the British soldiers, when they attacked the next day, right up to 100 kilometers away from Boston, every single town was prepared for Britain attack. Mm. Mm. So they were prepared. So the British idea of surprising Americans didn't work out because the kind of network that this guy had, and therefore the information spread. So it was no longer private information. It was no longer surprise to it that people were aware that the British soldiers were going to attack, right? So right from those days, even earlier as well, it was all networks.
So that was called the Freedom Run at that point of time, no?
Yeah. So people call it in the sense that the ride that Paul Rivery did in order to tell American soldiers that Britain is going to attack, right? So ever since, right, access to private information only comes through face-to-face networks.
Okay.
And this was also the reason why stock markets and prosperity was very localized because it was through face-to-face interactions that people came to know of business opportunities.
Correct.
And thanks to technology, that some of it got democratized. That we can participate in entrepreneurial ventures, and we don't. And geography is slowly becoming irrelevant. That if you were born in London, if you were born in Bombay, you had a different opportunity space around you than if you were born, let's say, in Vijayanagaram or Tiruvayaru. So the opportunity space around you was constricted those days. So technology has enabled you to be relevant,
correct.
And geography has become irrelevant, right? So, but even today, it's face-to-face networks that matter.
Absolutely, I agree with you.
So there was this game, Warcraft of the World, World of Warcraft, some years ago.
Yes.
It was a networked game. People could participate from any part of the world. Mm-hmm. But communication scholars looked at the data and felt that the probability of two young people coming together to form a group fell down at the square of the distance. That if a person is, let's say, 10 kilometers away, it's about, so you have 100 times less likely to be part of the same team. So these are youngsters who grew up on internet. So even for them, proximity played a very important role in forming teams and communities. Yeah. So face-to-face for us humans is very important, but technology has made us
I think we've lost the prof there, but yeah, technology. You said technology has made us, and we lost you there. If you can repeat that, sir.
Do you want me to move to a slightly better location?
I think so. If it works for you, fine. You were saying we can continue with this.
Yeah, let me just walk a bit.
This is also normal. We have bad networks across Bangalore, so, and maybe India.
Guys,
keep asking your questions, because Professor can tell you about incubators, the role of incubators, the role of networks in building a business. In fact, many of you who come to my live ask about networking, and we can talk about how networking and business tie in together. So keep your questions coming in. And you know, Professor, maybe we should also chat about this subject where everybody now says, you know, I'm going to a particular event to network, but you should know how to network also. One is, you laid out this point there, you should have good communication, and it's face to face, and you should be precise and concise, or have clarity with the idea when you network, right? Precisely, what are these networks? Because we have networks like Facebook, LinkedIn, we have forums like Quora, and you know, a lot of the startups or the early idea entrepreneurs go into these networks, try to do some studies. In fact, several of them try to launch a closed beta. But then, you know, many of them come back saying, I'm not able to scale my network. Why?
So when you say scale, in the sense that how do you get users?
Yes,
isn't there a couple of the completely different things,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely.
So first of all, there are networks where the network should be helping you. You as an entrepreneur in getting your name dropped, getting private information to you. That is one aspect of networking. And who you talk to matters a lot. So let's first talk about going to a conference. Right? So when we go to a conference, we tend to shake hands with few people,
yes,
but end up talking to people like us. So I'll immediately go to people who speak Telugu or from Vishakhapatnam, or if you go to a conference abroad, then we'll look at people who are like us, maybe South Asians, maybe Mexicans, right? So there is huge bit of identity that we carry, and we tend to network along our identity.
Yes.
Right? So that is very bad way of networking. And let me tell you, I keep hosting MBA kids from US, and I really like the way they call us for networking events. Mm-hmm. So everybody comes well-dressed, first of all. They mean business. And then they come and talk to you for 5 minutes. They introduce themselves. Hi, I'm so-and-so. I'm studying blah, blah, blah. I'm from Mexico. I'm interested in A, B, and C. I went to your incubator. I saw this startup, and chats for 5 minutes and says that, look, I'm interested in solar power. So if you know anything, do let me know. Thank you very much. I'll go meet somebody else. Right. So exactly 5 minutes he spends with and then moves on to another person. So it's like, so they spend time, and I look at our students here and they are not doing any different than what we do. They all tend to hang out together, back thumping, ha ha ha, hoo hoo hoo. Right. So we're very parochial in our networks, and that's very strongly embedded. So I can understand if you're going to a social event where you're meeting friends. At business events, you will have to meet new people.
Yes.
Right? Yes. So you will have to step out and shake hands. And when somebody asks you, don't go on for like 3 minutes telling what you do. Have your pitch ready, right? Practice. 30 seconds, I am into this. So what do you want in this event? This is what I want. And I have seen these American kids practice that little bit, right? And it comes in very useful when you are at events to be very precise, to the point. And people come up to me, can you help me? Right? Without really understanding, why should I help you? Right. So, but some come to me saying that, look, I looked at your, as you said, I looked at your YouTube. I looked at an article that you wrote long ago and you were mentioning this. Do you still work on that? Right. I'm naturally inclined to talk to this person because he has done his homework.
Yeah.
Right. So people need to go. So when you're meeting people whom you're meeting new, so see if you could do some homework while you go there.
Right.
Figure out who's going to be there. Be prepared, right? Serendipity comes because you're prepared, not because... First of all, serendipity comes because you go there, and serendipity comes when you are talking to people, meeting new people, and improving the odds of getting a connection. So now technology. So once you meet people, in the past, our ties used to decay very rapidly. Because you had to call up, calls were expensive. Otherwise, I don't know if you guys know, we are from the letter generation.
So am I.
So we actually wrote letters, right? So we used to eagerly wait for letters, right? So, and for days, we had no idea what was happening at home. You were in engineering college. The only time your parents knew you were alive was that, please send me money.
Yeah.
Right. Other than that, you are not really. And then for days on. So now if you don't call for 4 days, people say, why are you so busy?
That's true.
Right. Earlier, like for days, you wouldn't hear. So the pace of communication has gone up, which means that we have lesser attention now.
And patience.
Because, anything, please, whatever you have to say, say it in 140 characters.
Yeah.
Because anything more than that, you lost me, right? So technology has helped us keep our networks alive. And that's something we need to be very thankful about.
Yes, and you're right when you said it's democratized it, because when I do these shows, I share my number openly. There are a whole host of startups pitching their ideas to me, but you're absolutely right. I can't look at everything in detail. I have to look at it in 140 characters or something quickly so that it's concise. And I'm sure when they go to a investor, they have to do it in lesser amount of time. Like you said, a 30-second pitch.
Yeah.
And that 30-second pitch will decide whether that person's going to take your card seriously or not, right?
Yeah, true. A lot of things happen. A lot of things, little bit serendipity. Sometimes you wait for an opportunity to talk to someone.
Yes.
And then... you will always have them. I'm not saying that you won't have them. You always will have them. But be prepared, turn up. And the other way in which it happens is if you help people.
Correct.
So what kind of person are you? Are you a helpful character? Because are you a helpful character? Because help also is a little bit clever. As in you need to be not seen as a doormat.
Yeah, I get it.
Right? So you need to help. And those of y'all are looking at networking, there are some wonderful videos by Heidi Roizen.
I'm going to write that. You want to spell it out for you? Heidi, right? H-E-I-D-I?
H-E-I-D-I-R-O-I-Z-E-N.
R-O-I-Z-E-N.
Heidi Roizen.
And this professor, this is a professor of...
No, he's not a professor. She is a Silicon Valley person. Mm-hmm. Very good at networking. Mm-hmm. And some of the things that she talks about networking is incredible. And it works for all of us in terms of reciprocity, in terms of creating opportunities, in terms of reaching out to others, in terms of asking for help. Because one of the biggest thing as entrepreneurs is, how do we ask so that others give?
Sir, and another thing, I work in the Valley. So this, in the Valley, I want to share this with you. Maybe you can correct me. You know, in the Valley, you can do several meetings around the same block. You could do at least 7-8 meetings. And everybody is interested in the first 4 or 5 minutes of your pitch. You know, what is your idea? Okay, can we work together? Or they will say, okay, can I connect you with someone I know? It's a very high, it's an ecosystem which wants to help give back. It's not withholding any information, right? Where do you think India is in that journey in terms of this hyper networking, fast meetings? You know, it's connected to technology, finance, and several other things. And the ecosystem itself is open to sharing. They have no qualms about saying, okay, I don't want to give you this number or that number.
I think better still is Israel.
Okay, tell me about it. I've never been there, so please tell me.
So I was talking to an Israeli, mm-hmm. and I was there. I was there trying to get a networking meeting. Mm-hmm. And this person asked, so when did you write? I said, 3 days ago. Mm-hmm. He said, this person can't give you half an hour in 3 days. What kind of manager is he? So the thing is, they really give you the first half an hour, okay. Not 4 minutes. Unless the first half an hour is yours. Is it in better than Valley? And then they'll help you out. It's a small, small country, right?
Yes.
A few hundred kilometers, and everybody knows everybody else. And they are genuinely interested in knowing what you do. So first half an hour is yours. And if they're not interested, you will never be able to get a meeting again.
Okay, wow, interesting.
Right? But the thing that I really like about the Valley is exactly what you said. I can't help you, but I know 3 others who can help you out, and let me connect you to them. So they seem to have this very helpful way in which they build networks. And that is another aspect of networking, which not many do, is networking is not about your network. It's about how you help people whom you are connected to with their networks.
Yes. And it's also...
They should also...
It's also a karma effect, right? I do good to this man. At some point of time, he'll come back
yes.
to me.
Right. Help you or help somebody else. So,
yes.
So Valley is all about paying it forward. And if a whole ecosystem is paying it forward, you will be a recipient of somebody's generosity at some point of time. Right? But I think Valley is not built in 10 years. Look, ours is a 10-year ecosystem. Let's not forget that. Yeah. We are trying to compare Bangalore 100 meters champion to Usain Bolt. So it doesn't work.
Yeah.
So there are lots of positive things that we have about our ecosystem, but our learning can be far more rapid. Because we have ecosystems like Silicon Valley to draw from, a number of Indians who are out there who would be able to help us, right? So I see Bangalore compared to 10 years ago, mm-hmm. it's a wonderful place, right? It's a wonderful place to
network.
We are not yet there in terms of really helping others, but we need to get there. We need to really get into a network of helping one another. Mm-hmm. And this is where I see, from a network point of view, that how do you see an ecosystem? We are not yet an ecosystem. We are individual bunch of actors with our own set of people around us.
Okay.
But we are not connected to each other.
So you're saying we are siloed networks, gated networks. So I'm a set
we
of
are siloed gated networks.
I'm a set of investors who knows a set of entrepreneurs, and that's that. And you know, maybe if somebody gives me an invitation, I'll come and check that person out. Right? Okay. So how do you break that system?
So the old boys networks, yes. Where identity networks, but all of it is going to change.
Okay,
how does it evolve?
Professor,
so look at the valley.
You want to get your phone a little down because I see a little more down, please. We can't see you well. Yeah, there. Yeah, you're fine.
Okay. Yeah. Good. So the way I think is, it's part of the evolution, and it's also the comfort and the confidence that you have in your and your network capability. And that will come in slowly. If you look at Indians in the valley, they were hitting up to CTOs, but never getting to CEOs. Right? So valley was not that inclusive, let's say 20 years ago.
Was it not? I would know about the valley only from 98. But yeah, maybe.
I'm just assuming because of some of the things that I started to read. Mm-hmm. But they have an advantage, right? The Shockley 8, the traitorous 8 that came out of Shockley to set up Fairchild Semiconductors, they seem to have created a culture that you are wedded to your problem and not to the institution. Mm-hmm. So you could come out of Shockley Lab to set up Fairchild, you could come out of Fairchild to set up Intel, you could come out of Intel to set up Qualcomm, right? So it doesn't matter, but you are just part of there and you are trying to. So they have a little bit of edge on us because the origins there were renegades.
Yes.
So that's how Valley started.
Yeah, you're right. And Intel started way back in 69. So yes, you know, you're talking about time before that also. You're right. Absolutely. They have an edge over us only there, right? But we'll catch up, I'm sure.
Yeah. So we are very rapidly scaling up, right? If 12 years ago, if somebody gave you, let's say, 100 crore rupees and say, blow it in 1 year, I'm sure no startup in India could have done that. Right? And these days we can do it very fast. We can spend money very fast, right? Yeah. So I believe that it's an ecosystem that's evolving. Mm-hmm. There's a lot to learn, there's a lot to give, but I feel that we should be little bit more helpful to one another. Mm-hmm. If we can get to that level, I think we will scale up very, very rapidly.
Okay.
If you break down our silos.
Okay. I like this that you got to, you know, collaborate together and get into the habit of helping. But, you know, yes, we have followed the valley model of scale. Like you said, you can blow up 100 crores in a matter of a quarter these days. And, you know, you have, and, you know, people live in that's a bubble network for me in many ways. The COVID has proved it in many ways too. So how do you think we should become networks which are sustainable? Like, I mean, let me talk about the gated networks. I mean, the Tatas of the old days who set up, you know, gated communities around the factories, you know, built culture of excellence around them. You know, then obviously the technology world obviously cannot be talked about like the industrial world. How do you think it'll evolve post-COVID? What type of networks would you recommend? If any entrepreneurs are watching this, how can they start building networks of sustainability?
So if there's anything that COVID has taught us, mm-hmm. that we should be empathetic to others. It's not about us anymore. That if we have to survive, it is not what you do, but what others do, mm-hmm. which will help us survive.
Okay.
Right? And I think if we take this into our post-COVID, and as we get out of this, if we don't forget that it is a collective effort to survive and grow. And we are symbiotic. We have relationships with each other. And just because things are happening outside doesn't mean that it's not going to affect you. It will affect you.
Absolutely.
So therefore, we should be as giving as possible with our attention, with our time. And I believe we should really be a little bit more critical of ourselves. Because so what happens is, if somebody comes to me and asks for an impression, what do you think?
Of a product
or an idea. I studied in the Netherlands. Mm-hmm. If you don't want an honest answer, don't ask that question to Dutch.
Okay.
Because they're absolutely forthright on your face. So let me tell you, give you an instance. Like, it's me and my other PhD colleague, we were wanting to go in the evening, 4 o'clock. We thought, okay, let's do some interesting things. Go around Amsterdam. So I did my PhD in Amsterdam. So it's a lot of interesting, it's an interesting town. For students, I mean.
Yeah, sure.
So we were planning to go out, and the supervisor comes and tells my colleague, he's a little bit more senior to me in the process. So can you go to this event?
Okay.
So this guy turns around and says that, are you asking me to go because you don't want to go there? It's a boring event and we don't have a choice but to say yes to you. And then he said, no, that's not the reason I'm asking you to go, because this guy is going to speak there. Mm-hmm. So it was straight on the face, right? And then the whole thing got clarified. Mm-hmm. If I was there, I would have sulked. Next day, I would have called up this friend. What do you think? Why do you think that fellow, why do you think he did that? Yeah. Right? So it was a bit very, very open society. And that's how the culture evolved. I'm not saying that we are getting better at it, but we need to understand that failure of a venture is not failure of an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. The fact that I'm saying that your product, I'm not saying it sucks, but even if I say it sucks, you should take it and look at the logic, right? So when we get feedback from people, we get very personal and very defensive.
Absolutely. Sir, and you'd also recommend that when you go for feedback, know who you're going for feedback. Sometimes you might hold somebody in high esteem, and you go there and ask them feedback, you know, they might not have the time to look at it, but might just say that, might brush them off saying, I have no time. It's okay. It's okay, right? It's okay. You can move on to the next person. How do you find the right person, the people who can spend time with you? There's a fine line between mentoring, people who listen to an idea. Because, you know, somebody, I mean, when you're an entrepreneur, you need immediate feedback. Like you said, an honest feedback. Is this thing going to work? Do you have to work on your product? Go back and do something. Maybe try a B2C to B2B, maybe B2B to B2C, you know, somebody who can give them definite answers. But I find that increasingly in India, it's about, oh yeah, it'll work out. You know what I'm saying? Oh, let me think about it, you know? And there's a stalling that happens after that. You know, it's really very difficult. I don't know whether that'll break. So what is your advice? I mean, how do you chase the right person who can give you immediate feedback?
So it's not about immediate feedback. Mm-hmm. One of our doctoral students here was trying to look at how people take inputs. Mm. So there is this construct called community of inquiry.
Okay.
That entrepreneurship is not a solo game, but it is a community of inquiry where you go to your mother who will say wonderful things about your product.
Correct.
You go to your mentor who will say decent things. But you go to a customer else and ask the things, right? So as an entrepreneur, you need to take all the feedback and not get too personal about the feedback. Look at the logic. What's the logic behind a person's reaction? And I wouldn't want people to say it's nice. That is hardly a feedback.
Okay. Yes,
so you will have to tell people, you give more critical comments. So That is a faculty that we don't cultivate in our nation. We don't give critical feedback to each other.
We play it safe. That's true.
So if you have age on your side or gray hair, I can say nasty things and people will listen. Right? So because you have gray hair, your wisdom. But if you go to a colleague who's your contemporary and he says, man, this sucks, you get very angry. Right? So I would suggest that be specific with your ask. What is it that you're seeking feedback on? Because which was this VC who had this wall of shame? Sequoia, was it in the US? So they have wall of fame on one side, on the other side they have wall of shame, where the ventures that they've said no to, which ended up being very successful.
Okay.
So the first thing I would like to tell everyone that there is no expert. And if you come and tell me, I am faking it to a little extent, depending upon whether I like you or not, I'll say yes, I'll avoid, because I wouldn't want to say anything nasty. Mm-hmm. But one third person, we are very frank. When telling somebody else, I don't think this person has a chance, blah, blah, blah. But that's not how we should be. Right. So that's certainly not how we should get into. We need to understand how to ask for feedback. We need to understand how to give feedback. This is a faculty that we need to develop. And just as much as failure has come to be accepted in Bangalore, taking feedback should be the next faculty that all entrepreneurs should get into. And we shouldn't fall in love with our product. That's another thing that I liked in Israel. They're not loving with the product at all. Too bad, man. If it doesn't work out, as I was talking to these young guys, and they were saying, you know what? I've been pursuing this guy to start. We started. It's been 3 months, but has not been able to give time. There are 3 customers waiting, but I think I'm not going to continue this anymore. I don't want to waste any more time on this. I'll go on to another venture. So the way in which the pace at which they work is very fast, and you don't see things coming on, they have no qualms shutting it down and starting something again, and then coming back to this a year later or whatever. So they're not in love with their technology, the product, their venture. Everything is part of their career.
You know, it's interesting.
Right?
I think it's interesting in our philosophy, they talk about don't fall in love. Be detached, you know, and it's the philosophy of the land.
Right.
Yet it's so difficult to implement, you know, and you're right. People in Israel, people in America don't fall in love with their product. They let it go, they let it evolve, and they come back with different ideas. Maybe the same idea evolves into something else. It's something that I think our ecosystem may evolve to, hopefully.
It will, because look, again, we are 10 years old. No ecosystem has evolved in 10 years time to where we are. And let's not forget, it is extremely unique feature of India. And I'm surprised with the way in which Hyderabad evolved even quicker.
Yeah.
Right? Gurugram is evolving, Hyderabad is evolving. So I think it's a wonderful time to be thinking of entrepreneurship in India now.
It has negativity, yes, because of the, you know, losses and the fundraising that, you know, only very few people get, you know. So you're right. Despite of that, I think opportunity is here to stay, you know, in this country.
Yeah. Yeah, certainly. And I think you should also leverage your network and get to bigger networks. Right. So how do you use referrals? How do you use strategic influence? And you need to use that as an entrepreneur to get your name dropped.
Yeah.
So which means that somebody has to be impressed with you.
What's your opinion on PR? For example, I have nothing against PR. People should use it strategically. But some startups, as soon as they raise money, think PR will create networks. I thought PR will only put your name out there, but it will not build your network, correct?
I completely agree. Network comes from trust, right? And PR networks is like house of cards. It may look interesting, but it can get blown away very rapidly if you don't create a brand, right? Look, at the end of the day, I would really be very, happy if one draws from this book called Small Giants.
Okay.
Right? Small Giants is this book where he says that he talks about companies that have been remarkable instead of scaling. Mm-hmm. So they're the best, right, in that particular space. They're not large. They're not what you would be a billion-dollar venture, mm-hmm. but they are extremely, extremely well known. Like, for instance, there is a chain in East US called Wegman. Wegman consistently ranked as one of the top places to work for in the US, competing with likes of Google, the likes of IBM, the likes of, and this is a small chain of stores in East part of US. And I'm told that when they decide to move to a new town, saying that we would want to expand to one town, mayors and cities fight to come in there. And it's a wonderful company to go there. When I went there, the food was really good. Why? I said, like, this pasta looks very good. The pizza looks very good. He said, we got few people from Italy to spend time with us. We trained all our kitchen staff into making the best pizza that is possible. And then the person goes back. So it's not about price. It's about the quality. So it's fresh fruit, locally made. Everybody gives time in order to talk to each other, help one another, right? So the small giants is what I think we should aim to be, not unicorns.
Yeah.
So be the best in your, and we have examples. You know Taza Tindi. I really love Taza Tindi.
I think the networks have gone a little berserk, but that's okay. We'll wait for the professor to come back. One second. You guys can see us, can you? Yeah, voice is breaking. We'll just come back. So yeah, voice is a bit choppy, but we'll come back. Give us a second, guys. But it's good to see startups taken off.
Okay. I think Suresh had a network problem. He's going to come back in a bit. Yeah, keep asking your questions. Yes, there you go. So all the questions that you ask me, Suresh is answering. You know, get direct feedback, spend time with people. I'm going to call Suresh now. One second, he's back. Yeah, Suresh is back. I think we had network issues, right? So I sent him an invitation.
Yeah, Prof, you're back.
So, great.
You got to lower your phone a little more. Okay, yes. People are saying, what is the name of the outlet you mentioned in the US? That
Taza Tindi.
It's Taza Tindi, right? It's what is the outlet in the US also? Was the mayor's lineup?
Wegman. W-E-G, Wegman.
Okay. So what about Taza Tindi that you liked? Is it because it's a place where a lot of people network and he's realized...
No. I just think that the way in which the whole business of customer care is incredible. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Out very rapidly. It's very cheap. Mm-hmm. Right? And in this current day and age, it's unbelievable how good food he gives at the price that they give.
Okay.
And that doesn't come without putting in hard work into excellence in terms of how they operate, how they take care of the product, mm-hmm. how quickly. So if you look at the outlet is so tiny, the number of people who go there are incredible. But the place doesn't, there are no hiccups there. You never you don't have hiccups.
They've worked out the entire line also, right? The supply line also is fascinatingly managed in Taza Tindi. It's fresh.
And they don't cook in the morning for evening. It's like every 40 minutes they make their chutney. Every 2 hours they make their idli. So I'm saying that we don't need to get examples only from tech world. There are lots of ventures all around us whom we can draw from, right? And it's all like, we do have stories now that we could relate to. ID Batter is good. They're doing incredible stuff, right? Licious. I'm a vegetarian, but the Licious story is very interesting, the way they started. So what I think is, we need our stories here. We need to know the early days of... So when Flipkart, Sachin Bansal was in the class, he was talking about how early days of Flipkart, of standing in front of Sapna Book House saying that please buy online. And they were showing pictures of their first the office in Wilson Gardens. Really bad, unbelievably startup-ish with mattresses. And we also have Abe Single, I think, of InMobi, showing their early days where they were camping, sleeping, right? So we have stories of our own stories, both in tech and non-tech. And we do have people who are trying to create interesting products. So I guess we need to learn from all of them.
Okay. And what do you think? Let's move on to accelerators a little bit.
Okay.
You know, because I think there's so many that popped up. There are co-working spaces that popped up, that launched accelerator programs. There were standalone accelerator programs, fund-led accelerator programs to understand deal flow. And, you know, it's interesting. Everybody participates. It becomes a certification kind of a thing, a 10 lakh check and a certificate saying you are part of this program. But in the end, ideas keep dying. It's okay. I mean, then they say that 95% of the startups die anyway. So I'm saying, when you're such a young ecosystem, you don't want to talk about death.
Not really. I think we shouldn't talk about death, but take another metaphor. Like, you're trying to learn cycle without falling. Doesn't happen, right? So entrepreneurship is like cycling. It's in your mind. It's between your ears. And for you to become entrepreneurial, certain pennies have to drop in your mind. So there's nothing about you that was different when you're starting to cycle and not knowing how to cycle, and that magical moment when you cycle. It's the same you, but something happened between your ears. And you will never forget it ever, as in you learn cycling. So I think entrepreneurship is similar. That there's something that happens in your mind, the penny drops. And until then, you could start ventures and then stop and then shut down ventures. But coming to the accelerator part, right? I think we got onto accelerators very rapidly. Because the way I look at incubators is, they should be the first place for anybody to start their venture. It is like a sandbox that you go and experiment. Whether entrepreneurship is for you, whether you like that feeling. A lot of people would like to be on that big giant wheel. But when you are on that giant wheel, when it comes down, that sinking feeling in your stomach, you hate it. Yeah, you want to get off. So maybe entrepreneurship will seem very interesting to you while you're outside, but may not be for you. So I think first port of call for anybody wanting to start.
Have we lost the professor again? Yeah, professor, we lost you for the last 5 seconds. If you could tell me about...
I said incubators should be the first port of call for anyone wanting to start a venture.
Okay, that's a good thing you're saying, because the government has also technology business incubators,
yes.
100 of them, I think.
Yes, so, okay. Yes, 270 or 280 of them.
Okay, 280 of them, okay.
And that should be where you should go to. It's a sandbox. And I would want an ecosystem like education. You have primary school, secondary school, high school, junior college, college. So however clever you are, even if you crack CAT, if you don't have a degree, you can't come to IIM. You could be a 100-pointer. But if you don't have a graduate, if you're not a graduate, you can't come to MBA course. You could be very clever, but we won't take you in, right? So an ecosystem should evolve where output from one entity should become the input to another entity. Right now, it's free for all. Everybody is trying to muddy the waters because they want to get to that venture before anybody else does.
Yeah.
So that's one thing. The second is, so when you are at an incubator, you learn the ropes of starting, and you could shut the thing down. But when you are starting again, you're starting completely differently.
Yeah.
So I've seen a lot of startups which had their first venture in NSR cell, not do well, but go out and start wonderful ventures. Nestaway is one of them. Auto Ninja is one of them, right? So
Auto Ninja was bought over by somebody recently, I think.
So. Right. ICICI Ventures bought Auto Ninja. And Amar Sahu started his venture on campus. Wonderful deep tech company, winning awards across the world, but had tough time getting customers. But his second venture, he did very well. Right,
I want to just clarify before we go any further. You know, a lot of audience are asking, does it mean an entrepreneur who doesn't come to do an MBA or graduate, does that mean?
Okay, let me quickly stop.
Yeah.
Our incubators are no longer for our own students.
That's a good way of putting it.
I just wanted to correct you very rapidly that most incubators now are open to anybody from outside. And NSR cell has been one of the earliest to open, and we from day one were open to outsiders. So
just
look for places.
Just books is
from there. I don't know. Amagi is from there. Mango Technology is from there. Milap is from there. So we have a lot of interesting startups that came from NSR cell. Right, One Click, which was acquired by Freshdesk, was from there. Zuzubee, which got acquired recently, was from there. So we do have a bunch of interesting companies that have done well, and all of them came in with just a slide deck. And we have seen successful ones in the first venture. We have seen even more successful ones in the second venture. So I think it's a bit like playing. You play ones and twos, and then go forth. So I would come back and say the reason why accelerators, we need to get together, and that is again, a network of accelerators is not happening. Network of incubators is not happening. If somebody is from an incubator in IIT Kharagpur, I see no reason why he can't come to IIM Bangalore for 3 months and look at customers, right?
Why isn't that happening? It should happen. I mean, everybody says, even between the IIMs, they say IIMA is the best, and they have such a big fund. But then why can't those entrepreneurs come share with Bangalore? You know, I often miffed, why can't there be a network within all institutions, like you mentioned, all engineering colleges, schools maybe also, and then create a pipe into places like yours, right?
So I would say that we are all looking for personal glory as yet. And our identity is still individualistic and not yet collective, right? So like, for instance, if I keep looking at incubators and accelerator WhatsApp group, and they say a lot of great things about startups, saying that Jyoti or Fabric Mond, who was our incubatee, is doing very well. But Jyoti started at NSR cell.
Nice.
Right? I don't want to say that. So she's part of Startup OSS with IIM Ahmedabad that started. She's part of something else, a couple of other startups. Right? So I think it is okay if NSR cell doesn't say she was one of us, right? We did the best. She calls us, we are available. and she's doing well. So that's what we want. So the reason why it's happening is we don't have identity as yet. And collectively, we don't believe that we are all working towards creating good ventures. We want that glory to be ours and ours alone.
That should change. That should change immediately. That's a very deep thought that you put in also. And I hope the government, as it's met its, I don't want you to comment on the government per se, but on the government side, do you see them achieving some kind of impetus into getting more entrepreneurs to come to their incubators? Or is it left to private players who probably do a public-private partnership to build the network for the government itself?
No, I look at the number of incubators, which like IITs, IIMs, NITs, they're all wonderful incubators. And a lot of interesting stuff is coming out of there. Maybe not yet interesting to investors. As I told you, that is not the purpose of incubators. Incubators are not gatekeepers for investors. And investors are only looking at those companies that are inherently scalable, that will give them 10x value in 10 years' time, right? And they're very tiny, few set of ventures which have those characteristics. So I do not think we need to build startups for investors. We need to build startups to solve our problems. And problem, you could be a 10% company, profitable. I think I'm happy with that. Just as much as I'm happy with Zuzubi, just as much I'm happy with, the kind of things our women entrepreneurs are doing. They're small ventures, but they're doing wonderful work. I don't know if you keep track of our women entrepreneurship program that we do. Mm-hmm. Look at companies like Kutuki. We have Meet Kutuki is doing
well. K-U-T-U?
K-I.
Kutuki. Okay. And what else?
So they are doing well. Meeta is doing well. Thankfully, your story has been covering a lot of them of late. So we are very, very indebted to y'all for giving some spotlight to our women entrepreneurs. Your story has done wonderful in terms of giving us some spotlight for our women entrepreneurs. And I think it is very important that this spotlight is good for everyone, right? And yeah, especially all our women.
Our founder is a woman too, so she realizes.
Yeah, yeah. Know her for many years, so she started when we were doing all our bar camps and early days of her, and early days of our eco building activity was quite similar, right? So So I would suggest that we should be coming back to our accelerators, right? We should be happy with creating ventures which are like small giants, which are profitable, and we should be happy even if they have 10 employees, which is wonderful. And that is what we should be working towards. And from these, they will get to a level where some of them will be scalable. Some of them will close their venture saying that I'm not hungry. I want to grow faster. And then that's how ecosystem evolves. Right? So ecosystem doesn't evolve by creating unicorns. Ecosystem evolves because you're building ventures that are profitable. You're building ventures which are built on strong business fundamentals. And you do that, and you do a lot of them, and you will see how quickly the whole nation is going to change, because all these ventures solve local problems. Women ventures solve women problems, right? So ventures solve local problems. If you have rural ventures, it's time to start incubators in rural areas.
Do you think we need different networks for rural areas? Because I think, and a lot of the audience had rightly pointed out that, look, India is one nice place when it comes to English. It is about 100 million people. But what about the rest of the country? Can we have entrepreneur potential from these rural networks? And who creates these rural networks? Because I see only government and NGOs-led networks there.
But look, So I can tell you very quickly. I was talking to a small rural incubator in Vizag, and me and another person, mentor here in NSRCL called Naga, and we asked the incubator to go find out if there are any small enterprises in your neighborhood who wants to scale. And they found 90 of them. So I couldn't go meet them, but my our chief mentor Naga went to meet them. And I was quite surprised that some of them are doing 18 lakhs a year, 90 lakhs a year. And they're all wanting
retail
to scale.
Retail businesses.
There are fisheries. They could be farmers. So all different. So imagine if we tell them how to do business, what is marketing, what is finance, how do you keep your books? A lot of them end up learning by doing and have very inefficient frameworks to rely on.
Okay.
So if we take any of these ventures and get them to very quickly understand bookkeeping, understand a little bit of supply chain management, efficiencies of buying things in bulk, right? So if you start to tell them general business management in a local language, they'll start to be sustainable and start to be providing local jobs, right? And take crafts. You are rural craftsmen. They have wonderful skills. And they're turning here and becoming security guards at ATM. That man could weave a wonderful piece of textile. And if he was in any other country, he would be seen as a living legend. Japan has this construct called living legend, that you have skill sets that are so legendary that we respect you as a national treasure. But in India, he's coming and manning our security, right? Because it's paying. So time, and COVID is now very good because all of these people have gone back. It's time to get entrepreneurship in rural areas as well.
I hope it happens. Right? So, really, I mean, it's a tough ask. And like you said, living legend concept in Japan is amazing. They even respect nib makers.
Yeah, unbelievable. So, right. So, overall, I am very gung-ho about India and entrepreneurship. We have come a very long way from where we started 10 years ago. I think there is a lot to be proud of as a nation, as a collective. I know we say nasty things about our ecosystem to people from... I tell them the other way around. I said, you didn't know where we were 10 years ago. So one of the fastest growing ecosystems in the world. And we are solving our own problems. And it is this plurality in ventures is what we should expect. And we should not aim to be gatekeepers, nor should we for investors, nor should we want to create every venture, should not want to be a unicorn. And unicorn construct gone with this COVID
pandemic, yes.
Fundamentally,
I hope they knock it off the lexicon, really.
they are mythical creatures.
Yes, interestingly, let's get back. There's so many audience questions.
Let's get to the questions. Yeah, it'll be interesting.
Quickly. Yeah, so they're saying, according
to you. You pick.
I'm picking them. This is from Arjun, who says, with your experience of meeting so many startups, what are the top three reasons, based on your field of study, why do you think they fail?
First of all, I think they fail because they fall in love with technology or fall in love with their idea.
You mentioned that, okay.
Right? And I think you need to fall in love with problem. And that's a cliche. It seems like a cliche, but it isn't. There is a lot of truth to it. You would like to work with children and then see how you can solve that problem. Second is that they don't want to take your feedback. They just want to listen to what they want to hear, what they want to listen. Right? If you say this doesn't work, we get too defensive. So try to understand the logic behind what somebody says. The decision is yours at the end of the day, but I think it is your call. But meet mentors, meet a lot of people. People will say good things about you. People will say bad things about you. That equanimity is what is very important, first, second. And third is Are you helpful? Are you creating networks? Are you working with others? Are you collaborative? Because a lot of us do not realize that we work in a resource deplete environment. And we need to form communities, and we need to form collectives, and we need to collaborate. And I've seen that, I've seen very little of that. So those who collaborate, I've seen some entrepreneurs, wonderful guys, say that I'll help you out, I will do this, let me know. So they are very forthcoming, they're very helpful. I ask them, let's say, oh, yeah, I'm so sorry, I asked you yesterday to talk to a bunch of people, but there are a few more people, would you want to talk? Yes, sure, right? So I see positive attitude is what makes a lot of difference, right? And those who think the purpose in life is to focus only on the venture are sadly surprised that by doing a whole lot of other things is how they end up bringing in value into their ventures.
It's a tough ask, right? Like you mentioned, you need to, it's like a balancing act. Build your product, but don't fall in love with it. Don't fall in love with the solution. Network, but also focus on your product. It looks easy, but they have...
No, I mean to say that your perspective changes if you start to help others, when you interact with others.
That's also
so. So that's like a large window. So your own venture idea starts to change in your own mind, which is why you need to have mentors, which is why you need to have advisors. But don't follow what they say, follow what you want to do. Hmm. But look at the logic behind what they are saying.
Okay. You know, in the early part of the last decade, when we saw the rise of LinkedIn, then came, you know, Facebook, then came Twitter, obviously together at the same time. You know, how did these intrinsically change the way one networked with each other? Did it become a club in a sense? Because I go to Twitter, I only see political views, you know, one bashing the other. LinkedIn has become a place for a gated place for professionals, right? And there are some places for, engineers go to GitHub and all that, right? There has to be some kind of a, you know, again, we're trying to gate ourselves all the time. So what has been the impact of various networks in the world? And is there a case for Indian networks for Indian as such?
I don't think so, but the problem has now become attention. There's far too many, and there's fear of missing out is very deeply rooted in us, right? Oh man, Facebook, something exciting is happening. Twitter, something exciting happening. Insta, something exciting is happening. So we seem to forever be saying that we may be missing out. So leverage technology for the advantage that it has. So LinkedIn and Facebook, you can keep up your old ties. One of the things that research has shown is how do you revoke your dormant ties? We underestimate the power of dormant ties. People who are on your mobile phone that you haven't spoken for 3 years. Right? So call them up and talk to them, and no purpose networking. Networking when you have work is different from networking when you have nothing else. Let's go for a cup of tea, which is why most innovation happens during water coolers when there's no purpose to conversation. And water coolers are supposed to be the greatest source of innovative ideas. That's because there's no purpose to conversation there. And people underestimate, it's called, people may think it's wasting time, but that's not true. So when somebody asks you to come, let's go have tea, let's go do this, do that, meet interesting people, right? That's face-to-face. So how does this work on technology? When you meet interesting people, you take them onto technology so that your ties don't decay very rapidly. And you can revoke your dormant ties leveraging technology. Keeping in touch with others. Yes, Twitter is becoming trolling, and we are becoming very political in our views. But people need to understand that Twitter is not, it's armchair activism.
Activism, yeah.
So don't spend time trolling people. Don't spend time getting angry at, oh, you're a buck, you're a liberal, whatever terms that are calling. Those are all irrelevant for us, man. Like, we need to work for a living. We need to focus on our learning and a product. So don't engage in all this conversation. Just focus on your
build
work.
Product. Yeah, build the product.
Build product. And you have communities there. You said GitHub, Hacker News, Twitter is one's capabilities. There's so much.
I think we're waiting for you to come back. Yeah, Twitter.
There's so much that happens on Twitter, which is so interesting. I've been following on microbiologists. I've been following up on historians. I've been following up on network scholars. And so I'm not saying it's easy to get away from all these political conversations that are happening, but I tend not to get involved and use it only for knowledge building, only for keeping up with my networks.
Okay.
So that's how you focus. So as much as it is a great value add, it's also a sink, and one needs to be careful. How do you leverage? And LinkedIn is, have I used LinkedIn? Yes, I've met interesting people. I've got lots of inputs onto my research from LinkedIn. And if you are entrepreneurship, an interest in entrepreneurship, please go to Google Scholar. You have lots of interesting scholarly articles there which are available. And I think a lot of literature is available. So spend time on Google Scholar. So technology has enabled us and brought us very close. Like, for instance, on LinkedIn, I sent a message to Heidi Rosen saying that, look, I'm going to be in San Francisco. Are you free? Would you meet? So she wrote back saying that, look, I'm glad to be know that you're using my case in the class and things like that. But that's the day of my daughter's graduation. I can't meet. But I've reached out to a lot of people whom I wouldn't have been able to get to otherwise.
I think that's the first thing all entrepreneurs should do today. Go back to your contacts that you haven't spoken to for 3-4 years. Go network with them. So just say hi. That's a good...
Yeah, dormant ties. Invoke your dormant ties. Right? I really think...
Invoke dormant ties. That's a great phrase.
Right. I just want to also talk about 3 aspects of networking now that we're talking about it. So there is... One is known as your operational network. Okay. This is the work, the net part of a network which helps you get your job done. Mm-hmm. So... All the network that gets your job done is operational network. And the second is your personal networks. So the focus of this network is you as an entrepreneur, you as an individual, to help you improve your capabilities. So the first network helps you with your job. Second network helps you with yourself. And the third network is strategic networks that help you with your future. So when you're meeting people, figure out where would you want this person to be in your operational network or your personal network or your strategic network. So all these 3 are very important. This has been written, there's a wonderful article on leadership networks by Herminia Ibera, H-E-R, Herminia Ibera. And
H-E-R, I'm going to put that in, H-E-R.
Herminia, H-E-R-M-E-N-I-A, I-B-A-R-R-A. She's at INSEE.
I-B-A-R-R-A. Got it. I-D-A-R-R-A, okay. She's a motivation speaker, or she's a researcher?
So she's a faculty, so she's a scholar, Ibera. And she works a lot on networks, especially gender networks, on leadership networks. She has wonderful articles. You could look at YouTube. You could look at some of the articles that she has written for S+B. And again, women networking is very difficult. So she has written a lot on women networking as well. So she is a faculty in London, in INSEAD. And I really like this construct of differentiating between operational network, personal network, and strategic network. In the research that she has done and some of the research asking entrepreneurs here, your strategic network is the weakest for entrepreneurs, and that should not be the case.
Okay.
So you should. So people are very good with their operational networks. Mm-hmm. Personal networks are okay, but strategic networks are very hard.
So operational, personal, and strategic. And strategic, yes, are the ones that are going to make your startup scale, right? And also give you feedback.
No, operation is one which will get your task done.
Okay.
So that's part of your network as well.
Correct.
Personal is makes you different as an entrepreneur, as a person, improve your personality, get your name dropped. So all three are important. Mm-hmm. All three are important. So you need to understand the functions and faculty and manifestation of these networks for your venture. All three are important for different sets of activities and for different focus, your venture, your task, and yourself as an entrepreneur.
You know, this is great knowledge. I mean, Prof, I mean, where do we get your white papers? Or have you written a book? Forgive my ignorance. I don't know, but I know
no,
papers
I haven't written are available. My book. Okay. Yeah, my papers are available in Google Scholar.
You could look up on Google Scholar, right? Okay.
Google Scholar, Suresh Bhagatla, and then yes, mm-hmm. Some of my papers are there.
Why haven't you written a book? Tell us about that. You know so much. I mean, we could use somebody. I mean, all of us go to the Valley for information. It's in the backyard in Bangalore. Why should we go to the Valley? I mean, you people should collaborate and probably write many more books. I see,
yes,
a lot of journalists, yes, writing books on the subject.
Yes. Yes.
Why not academia?
Well, I don't know if it's laziness, but it's just that we've taken it with a lot of things, but you're right. In terms of access and creating books, I think we need to get into a habit of writing books, and more because I guess it will also be local knowledge, right? And I think creating local knowledge is, yeah, you're right. I haven't done that. Maybe I should look at this as a motivation and a little bit of a knock-up to say that if we don't create our own knowledge sets, who will do it for us? Yeah,
think
I completely
about it.
Agree.
There are thousands of questions just floating down. I mean, literally. And I can't take all of them. I'm feeling sad. I'll try to take 2-3 more and let's see.
Yes.
There's one from, this is a handle called Salam Everyone, and they're talking about higher education to promote entrepreneurship. Can it be designed to promote startups and then also build research? I mean, one, research on startups, academia, and also then promote ideas. For example, you go to Stanford, Andrew Ng, right? He's from there, no? He's not only an investor, but also is on board of so many startups, right? And his course on Coursera, I think, is the bestseller even to this day, and on AI, I think. Now, how can we build that culture is something Salam Everyone asks.
So I guess, okay, let me do a little bit of a shameless plug-in. I have a course on edX called Do Your Venture.
Okay.
So if anybody, any of your friends anywhere wants to have a little bit of a structured way of thinking through one's venture, Do Your Venture helps you. And we have used it.
A lot of students are putting in saying that we took that course and we love it.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Yeah.
What is it called,
yes,
again? So I'll put it for the benefit of others. It's called EDX.
Do Your Venture on edX and IAMBX as well. Do Your Venture. As in, instead of plan your venture, do your venture. Be action biased.
It's on the IMB website, is it?
EdX. It's called Do.
You can write it down. Right. This is interesting. So you also have courses like that. Do you teach on Coursera, Udemy, and all those places, or is this IIM?
It's IIMBX, and we also have SWIM on edX. I'm on edX as well. Uh-huh. So edX, SWIM, IIMBX. It's a free course. Okay. So that's the starting point. And I think I'm planning to have a new course on networks, on a 5-week course, because this COVID time has been extremely good, because I've been giving lots of online sessions, and I think I would like to have another course on networks, and probably have one advanced course on entrepreneurship even, get to understand bootstrapping, get to understand equity, get to understand. So, I don't know if you have looked at Founder's Dilemma, the Naum Wasserman's book on.
Amazing.
So we're trying to do cases on India. So we started writing cases on Indian startups. So we are, all of those will be available for other universities to teach. Mm-hmm. So over the next 1 year, I think we're going to be very active on two fronts. One, put courses out on internet mm-hmm. for family business. I know Professor Kumar is going to start one on family businesses. Professor Vardhani is thinking of a course on working with large corporations. I'm thinking up of a course on networks and entrepreneurship to next level. So yes, we are researching, all of us research. Professor Dahlia has done wonderful work on networks and family businesses recently, so that's available as well. So we do international business. So what we have done, not done, is translate this scholarly work into more articles, maybe for your story or for so we have not translated that for everybody. So we kind of communicating only to academic scholars, and that's not nice, and that's not good. So yes, there's a lot of material available on bits and pieces.
If this is your first Instagram live, you should start taking lectures here, at least snippets of those lectures. You know.
Oh, wonderful idea. Yeah.
Zen Futurist asked me, where can you find your lectures that are democratized rather than, you know, not all of us can make it to IMB or pay for that executive program also. But can you do small lectures here under the name of the IMB or in your handle's name? And, you know, it could be great learning.
So I guess it is this pandemic, as we have been having this conversation inside IIM over the last so many weeks. Mm-hmm. And we are now agreed that we have to leverage technology. IIMB has been the first first institute in India to have 30 online courses on management. We had over 10 lakh people or 10 million people have taken our courses. Professor Vatsanthi's course, finance courses, operation courses. So we have lots of them. So if you go to edX and IIMBX, we have lots of courses which are completely free, but we are now looking at making it a little more accessible, having shorter, more interesting sessions. And I guess as faculty members, we are learning to leverage technology. We have started about 4 years ago. We have a digital lab. We have 30, 40 people working there. So yes, we need to do more, but MOOCs, we are very good. We have done a lot on MOOCs, but maybe shorter courses instead of going through Coursera is doing these nano degrees. We just started with a micro degree program. But yes, a long answer to saying yes to you that we should do Instagram, Insta Live or Facebook Live.
Maybe we could do this. We could pick specific topics and, you know, I could host you.
I'd be happy to do that.
And maybe we could get our audience to ask questions. I mean, probably you could explain the first 15 minutes of a concept. We could use the next half an hour to ask specific questions. We can then record that. Obviously, it'll be recorded. This is on IGTV. And then put it out to folks out there to learn. And then send questions to me, which we can answer again. Right?
No, I think that's a wonderful idea. Wonderful idea. Because I guess I've always been thinking there should be some translation of the research articles, right? So I could talk about what does this article say, and so therefore explain when do you network, what is a good time to network. So lots of interesting articles, and we could take from there. I'll be happy to do that. Let's see.
So we should take this forward. I know it's very late, and you know, just 90 minutes just went like that. There's so many more questions, guys. If I'm going to put this on IGTV, so if you can take your energies to IGTV in another 10 minutes and I'm going to post it there. Just make sure you put all your questions there. I'm going to, you know, tag the professor and IMB. And like we promised, we'll have discussions. We'll try to make him come back. We're going to pick up specific concepts. and try to make you better entrepreneurs. If anything, we go back home with great knowledge and we're going to be better people. We network better. Thank you for being on the show, Professor. You're a lovely
Thanks
person.
A lot.
Thank you again.
Really interesting medium. I guess this is, technology is the only way in which we could democratize knowledge. And I believe that I'm happy to come again. Let's talk and see how we could take this forward. I'll be happy to answer all your questions on Insta as well. So on and off, I try to be active on Insta once in a while. So look forward to interacting more, Vishal.
We'll work out something for them, 100%. Okay, that's a promise, guys. I'll get the prof back again. Professor, thank you. Have a great night.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Wasn't that lovely, guys? We often ignore academia. The kind of research that they do is amazing, and we need to make that more inclusive in our shows. And I will probably get more of the professors in, and I'll probably get Suresh again. I'll talk to him, and there's obviously his staff, and there are a lot of rules. So we'll try to get IIM on board and probably do these lectures, 15 minutes concept, and then you can shoot the questions, right? So any thoughts, you guys have my number, so you can message me and I'll pass it on to IIMB. You're awesome, my dear friends. And I wish I could call you live today. You have to forgive me, guys. Rohit promised to call you tomorrow. I've got a call with the company, which is from America, because they're going to come in tomorrow and I need to brief them about the show. Thank you, Startup Santana, for coming in. I know I've met you in a lot of events and you're amazing. Prachi, thank you very much. Zen Futurist, thank you, Equiseed. I hope your startup's going well, man. Nitin, your questions are awesome. So more questions tomorrow. It's going to be an AI startup, you know, in the field of HR. They've raised more than 100 million in the US. So it's an Indian person. You can shoot all your questions tomorrow on the show and get many more answers. Thank you, guys. What's my number? Quickly, I'm going to put it up. 9902054222. Okay. You guys may have to nudge me, because I have 80 stories to write. I have 4 videos to do every day, recordings, and this is a live that I do. I try to keep up, guys. And what do I gain? I gain your friendship, I gain knowledge. So that's it. Have a good one. I'll see you in a bit. Bye-bye. Good night.